All right, our seminar is Spooky City next Friday. Halloween seminar and familiar spirits. There it is. Lots of weird stuff going to go on next week. So be prepared for the unusual. We'll be praying for witches, sorcerers, warlocks, that kind of stuff next week, and asking God to love them and bless them and forgive them. Any curse they try to put on me or the building, just pray for them and ask God to forgive them for dumping them curses over here. We don't have any bad feelings about witches and warlocks. We want them saved just like we do everybody else. And we don't have any bad feelings about people who don't like us. Want them saved just as much as everybody else. It's not your job to take any offenses or get all shook up about anything. 10,000 years from tonight in my condo in the New Jerusalem, I won't remember what you said about me to him. And who cares? You know? Oh, Mike Smith, he sucks. Who cares 10,000 years from tonight? I'm in my condo in the New Jerusalem. I'm going to a worship service somewhere in heaven. None of this stuff's going to amount to a hill of dried beans. That's a fact. That's the truth. All right, let's get going. Albuquerque starts in November. That's October, isn't it? We're on KXEY or something like that. I'll get the details. Should have got it. We're going to be there at 10 o'clock every morning in Albuquerque. The station covers the whole city. So we'll get, there's about 800,000 or 900,000 people there, something like that, I think. It's not near as big as Phoenix, but about half the size thereabouts. And then I got an email this week about Anguilla. The guy that was, the rich guy that's going to pay for my station, sent a check in. So supposedly that's all paid for the next X amount of weeks. So we're going to be doing that pretty soon. And you folks have paid all the other bills. Muchas gracias. Thank you. Your donations are bailing us out. That's for real. Plus, we have extra every month. I put it in the building fund so we can get out of this building here. We need to get out of this building. We need more space. You know, we need more altar space. We need more sitting space. Americans don't like to sit next to anybody, so... You know, if you want 60 people there, God, you need 120 seats, unless you got family members, and they sit there out of habit. They can't stand each other, but they'll sit together. So strangers don't like to sit together. So you got to accompany all the people. You got to. So that's what we need. Plus, the most important thing is we need more altar space. We got to have bigger altar calls. If God can deliver 8 people here, he can deliver 18 or 28 or 58. That's no problem for the Holy Ghost. He just multiplies himself like it's nothing. That's right. He can do it. So we just need more space. That's what we need. All right. So the 2 new radio shows are going up in November. They'll both be running. And then we'll be on our way. All right. We've been going over our training series. This has been a training series on absolute, unequivocal truths that you have in order to have a full gospel, fully anointed ministry. If you skimp on any of these, there's a hole in your boat and the devil will find it, and you're going to come up short somewhere. But if you get these absolute truths in the bag, we can't lose. What were the first 4? Those were it there. There's our first 4 absolute total truths. The Holy Spirit, the love of God, God's love for humans, God's love for you when you were his enemy. Anybody remember any of those? Oh, yeah. And then we had 5 through 9. the sin of humanity. We went over that. And born and live in sin, 2 different things. And God's inability to have anything to do with us because of his character qualities, which are holiness, so on. Number 7, no relationship. Number 8, there's no way to get saved under any circumstances, with anybody, through anybody, anywhere, or any religion, or any person, nothing except the blood of Christ. That's it. That's the end of it. Buddha, Allah, Raphelson, Zoroaster, Mother Mary, the man on the moon, Mother Teresa, Father Time, you name it. You pick your own idol. You can't get saved because of the previous truth. We got a sin problem, and they cannot take away even one sin, any of those supernatural gods, whoever they are. You still have a sin problem. How are you going to get rid of your sin? That's the problem. Judaism does not work. You can't get saved in Judaism. Why not? Same thing. It's got a sin problem. We got problem with sin. Sin is a problem. Big problem. Everyone has a free will that determines everything. We went over how the devil treats your free will. We went over how God treats it. Okay? Totally different subjects. Absolute truth 10 through 14. Here they are. In the spirit world, God uses the Holy Spirit. He does everything through Him. And Satan uses demons, right? And because the Holy Spirit's omniscient, He knows everything. He doesn't need to transfer data to anybody else to affect communication. The devil is not omniscient and therefore has to transfer data. The devil has to get and receive data, but he's got to get it. He can't just get it like the Holy Ghost, who just knows everything all the time, before, after, during, and happening. Nobody else can do that but him. But the devil has to have a venue of communication, and that is demons do it. They have a transferring network of communication all over the planet, and it works extremely well. Highly efficient method of transferring data, but it has flaws. The Holy Ghost doesn't have any flaws. And then last week we finished up with 12, which was, if you want a Holy Ghost ministry, if you want to walk in the Spirit, it's going to cost you something. You're going to have to sacrifice something. And that word is a four-letter word to an American. Americans do not want to sacrifice anything, practically. They want it just quick, easy, and free. And that will not work in the spirit world. It's going to cost you something, sacrifices, to have a Holy Ghost ministry. So what I'm trying to do every week here is prep you for your sacrifices. And you will not get this information on TV, Christian television, or mega churches or anything like that. That's a seeker-friendly system designed to self-perpetuate, generating revenue, and maintain everybody's job. My job here is to, if you don't like it, I'll bend over, and you can start smooching. My job here is not to perpetuate my system and get rich. I'm to work my way out of a job. I'm going to drop dead, sir. I'm going home. I'm getting out of here. Before I go home, I've got to get this system set up, and this thing's got to be running and going. And then I'm done. And there it is. Next week is our Halloween service, and this is truth number 13. Okay. There's a difference between a Christianus, and a Mathetes, a disciple. Correct. All disciples are Christians. Less than 1% of all Christians are disciples. Yes. Let's follow it and see what the difference is. Luke chapter 14 is going to cost you something to have a Holy Ghost ministry. Apotasso, adios, as they say in Spanish. We have a lot of Spanish speakers in the state of Arizona. Adios is what this Greek word means. You have to be willing to say adios to anything God wants you to leave. See you. Goodbye. That's a disciple. Christians will not do that. They have certain things dear to their heart that they will not give up, come hell or high water. That's what leaves them as a Christian. A disciple is not that kind of person. Whatever the Lord's in the mood to call on, they'll cough the thing up. I'm done with it. I'm leaving it. Apotasso. See ya. I'm out of here. Paraconta. What? Your what? Your stuff. George Collin would call that what? Your stuff. Everybody's got to have a place to put their stuff. If you're a disciple, you don't care that much about your stuff. Everything you own, everything you have, it's expendable. It's expendable. Possessions. You cannot be my disciple. Guess what's going to happen to you if you're a Christian? This never happens to a disciple, but it happens to Christians. If you lose your moreno, if you become saltless or insipid, what the heck good is salt for? You say, well, this verse doesn't mean much. It doesn't now. That's true. But in biblical times, this was a huge statement, and it cut everybody to the core because everybody lived on salt. We live on what? Refrigerators. I got a refrigerator in my house. I got a refrigerator back there. It's about that tall, that wide. I got one in my office. That wide, about that tall. I got one in my house. Well, I will have one. I've always had a refrigerator. We all have refrigerators. Back then, they had no refrigerator. What'd they have? Salt. If your salt becomes useless, what the heck good is your salt? What's it for? Well, you just throw it out into where? Copria, the manure field. Where you defecate, where they dump the feces, that's what you are good for. You lose your anointing, you lose your faith, you can't salt anything anymore. You are good for what? The dunghill. Ma'am, I notice you're new here. Please don't panic at anything you see me do. This is not the mega church. No mega church pastor would go like this. I am the only pastor in America that does that. Don't worry about that. You know what you're good for? Boom, taking a dump. You're useless. You belong on the manure pile. My God, this is tough preaching, and I'm not preaching it. It says it right here. Men, just throw this stuff out. Man. Matthew 10, the disciples, not above his master. That brings us to the Greek word, mathetes, doesn't it? A mathetes is a hard-working, learning student, i.e., kind of like people that are A students, in a way, in grade school, high school, junior high, the A students, the people that work harder at their studies, people that make the grade, people who study extra on their homework. People who have an emphasis on learning. Yeah, for example, my granddaughters, okay? They're not like me or my sister. Yeah. Their parents, my older daughter and my son-in-law, they're education-oriented people, okay? So they pass those learning values onto my grandkids. I grew up in a house where everybody in the house is a big dummy. I had no of these values instilled in me through observation, through training, through parental emphasis. My grandkids, straight A students, gifted program, all that other stuff, see? I was in the Are You Gonna Make It program. Man, that kid's stupid. Look at him program. That's what I was in. I was not a Methodist, but If you got want a ministry and you want to be a disciple, you've got to get in a way, the gifted program. You've got to start pushing yourself. You've got to be coming, ardent, aggressive learner, things of the Spirit. Then you will never be greater than your master, Jesus, but it's enough for you to be as your master, didaskalos, teacher. This verse was mistranslated. It should have said, teacher, student, mathetes, teacher. It's good enough for you to be as your teacher. In our case, our teacher is the Holy Ghost, Jesus. We will never be greater. Not going to happen. It's enough to be like them. This is all part of the presentation, okay? What I do is I'll throw some stuff in and see if you're listening. Were you watching, ma'am? I'm watching you. You're I'm watching. We are to be as our incredible didaskalos teacher, the great teacher, Christ, the greatest of all. Luke 14. Here we have, we went over this 2 weeks ago. In Greek, it's an idiom of preference. It means you are to love God so much, your love for other things seems like, hey, here is where Christians in America, almost all of them break down here. Almost all of them stop and say, no, I can't be a disciple. I can't make it because of this. Your teacher, Christ, has to be greater than your children. And most parents, particularly mothers, cannot do it. So this one weeds out many, including wives and sisters and brothers and relatives. He must be here. It must seem like you hate them because you love here so much. Of course, you're to love them. That's absolutely required. But not in comparison to your ability and your love as a disciple of Christ. Okay? So this is a very tough area for people to give up if the good Lord comes calling and says, I need you to let your daughter, your son go, or what have you. Whoever does not bear, bastazo, endure their cross, they cannot come after me. What's he talking about? What we just talked about. Here is, Jesus went to the core of the human, which is what? The people you're usually closest to. Now, it's unfortunately, with dysfunctional families all over America, that's not always the case, is it? But generally speaking, you're usually closer to your family. And a disciple must be willing to cut, leave the family, and then to endure what you've sacrificed. They cannot be, hey, if you're not doing these things, if you can't do these things, you cannot what? No, you have to stay a Christian. Right? Don't worry about that girl. She's on her way to becoming a disciple. That's the beginning phases of it. And then you go move on from there. She'll probably be another Catherine Kuhlman. So we take our time with those because we want fruit. That's what I'm looking for. You cannot be, if you don't endure releasing your family, the ones you love the most, no disciple. You got to stay a Christian. Blech. Disappointing. Luke 14. Likewise. Oh, boy. Here, some people will not answer that call for love nor money, period. They can't do it. So this is, you know, just my own personal opinion. This is a reserve for super disciples, you know. I don't see many people who God ever asks, I want you to leave everything you've got. I mean, the odds of that are got to be incredibly low, even for a disciple. Okay, God, this is not going, but the concept here is, you have to be willing to do it if it were to be asked of you. The probability is low that it would ever be asked of you. But are you willing to do it if, perchance, you would be the one in a million or one in a billion to do it? Does that make sense? I haven't seen too many people. You know, I've seen missionaries who left everything. Yeah, that's true. You know, that'll happen occasionally, but usually not going to happen. No man can serve two masters. You have to hate one of them. Now, Christians in America don't hate sin or the devil. They seem more of a Halloween cartoon character. But a person that becomes a disciple develops a loathing, a deep-seated loathing for sinning and for Satan and demons. They hate seeing what the devil does to people. They hate seeing loved ones ill. They hate living in sin and breaking off their fellowship or their koinonia, their communion of the Holy Ghost. They develop a hatred for it. Christians don't do that. It's more like, oh, I wish I hadn't done that, or I don't like that. Wishing you hadn't done it and not liking it, that's not going to work. You have to develop hate for that cold-blooded murderer, hate for what he did to your family, hate for how he ruined your life, hate for the stealing your kids and getting them pregnant and getting them drunk and turning them into drug addicts, hate for what he done to your parents, drove them nuts, gave them a mental illness, murdered them with a heart attack, gave them cancer, hate, hate. If you can't do it, you can kiss your disciples, sit, goodbye. You get to be a Christian. It's a drag. Luke 14, which of you, intending to build a tower, Pergus, a castle? What's he saying there? Let's put it in perspective again. 2,000 years ago, what was a mansion then? Castles. Run it back forward 2,000. What is it now? You know, Wrigley Mansion up here, or over here in Paradise Valley, Lincoln, maybe, right? So Jesus is using his emotional and visual comparison to teach here. He's saying, hey, look at this. Here's a Wrigley Mansion, Mike, castle. Check it out. If you're going to build one of these big babies, you got to sit down first and figure out how much this thing's going to cost, man. You need an architect. You need some plans. You need some money. You need a credit line. And you need to sit down and figure out whether or not you've got enough to finish this thing. Disciples sit down and they just count that cost up. What am I giving up? What am I going to have to let go of? What do I got to do? What kind of time is this going to require of me? They sit down, they go, wait a minute here, I've looked at it, Lord, I'm ready to go. That's a disciple. Christians, you want me to do how much? Spend how much? Go where? Are you out of your mind? Oh! I'm just going to stay a Christian. Oh, that's no good, is it? Oh, gosh. You got to count the cost to finish this race as a disciple. Yes, sir. What will happen if you don't? It's embarrassing. Man, it's embarrassing. They're not able to finish their ministry. They can't finish their course. Paul said, hey, I finished my course. I've obeyed it. I kept the faith, he said. Paul sat down and he was the greatest Christian in history and he just counted that cost up. He said, hey, it's going to cost me my wife and kids, all my money. It's going to cost me my standing in Jewish society. Here I am, some big wig, some monster Superman in Jews. I'm a super Jew. What am I going to do? He wrote it, sitting down and looking at it. Oh, man, this is going to cost me all this stuff. He went over that when he was sitting in the fishing house there by the sea, blind, no water, no food. He's going over. He's counting his costs here. Because he said on the Damascus Road, Lord, what do you want me to do? I want you to count the cost, Paul. Here's what it's going to cost you. You're going to lose your wife. As soon as they find out you became a Christian, you're going to get... Jews are going to, whew, you're done, including your family. Your family's going to bag you like yesterday's garbage. You're going to lose everybody in your family, your son, your daughter, they're all gone. You're wealthy, aren't you, Paul? You're going to lose all your money. You got a lot of friends, don't you? You're a big shot. Jerusalem, you got nothing. You got no friends. Lord didn't tell him this, but Had he told him, he probably wouldn't have done it, but I'm going to send you a bunch of Christians. They're going to bag you too. Yeah, raise your hand. Have you ever been bagged? Don't do it. Ever been bagged by a Christian? Oh, whoa. I've been hung out to dry so many. Not going there. You're not going to have a friend left in the world, Paul. You know what? He went down that list and unbelievably, thank God. Thank God for us. Thank you. He said, yes. My God. And I'm teaching out of his stuff almost every week, 2,000 years later, because he said, yes, I will bag everything. I will lose everything, including what? Your health. What? Yeah. When you die, you're going to have bruises and cuts and scars all over your body. They're going to beat you to the gates of hell. You're going to lose your home. You got to sleep in a different house every night the rest of your life. Holy smoke, you get about my age and you can't do that anymore. Man, I got to have some place to faint. Paul went down that list and said, you know something? I'm in. Praise God. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Lord. How'd that one go? Finished up that 13th one. How about 14? Don't worry about that girl. She's becoming a disciple. This law is what I call, it's hidden in the Bible, I just made it up, universal laws. There's universal laws that apply to sinners and saints alike. They're the laws of the spirit world. And some of these laws apply to both sinners and saints, okay? And this is one of them. If you, sinner or saint, doesn't matter who, if you're a Christian, disciple, sinner, doesn't matter. If you sow to iniquity, you will reap nothing. Vanity in Hebrew means nothing, zilch, zip, you know. Zero, an empty bag. You will get so mad you won't even believe it. Boy, isn't that the truth. There's nothing more frustrating than having something and then sowing it and then losing it, ending up with nothing. You invested your time, your money, and your energy, everything, and you ended up with nothing. Boy, that pisses you off. Oh, that makes me mad. I've done that so many times over the years and got mad every time. That was mine. That's not funny. I just did it for me. 1 Corinthians 9, the law of sowing and reaping. Check it out. Sinners, saints. If you sow sparingly, you get to reap sparingly. Sinner, saint. Doesn't matter. Man, if you're a hard-working warlock, you're going to reap more than the other warlocks. You're going to get more spells. You're going to have more people dying of diseases. You're going to be cutting off more chicken heads. Whatever they do, I'm not exactly sure what they do. It's not my job description. But if you work hard as a real estate investor, you're going to have more homes, more equity. If you study hard, you're going to, you know, it all applies to everything in this world. Secular, spiritual, doesn't matter. Man, if you so work hard and sow lots, you're, generally speaking, going to reap lots more. Correct? That's basically how it works. He that sows bountifully reaps bountifully. Hey, there you go. The world's richest man knows that. Warren Buffett from Nebraska. When he was young, working 80 hours a week, whatever it was, studying like a maniac. Smartest guy in the world, greatest money, greatest stock market investor. And what was he doing? He was sowing bountifully into his chosen career. The same thing is true you. If you will sow bountifully in your whatever it is you're called to do, praying, casting out demons, healing the sick, worshiping, whatever it is you're doing, if you'll bountifully sow into that, you will reap bountifully. And if you approach it like, who gives a damn? Quote unquote, that dude, that's what you're going to get. See? You're going to get nothing. If you sow into sin bountifully, man, you are going to get sick and pick up demons you can't even believe. Yeah. Hitler, Stalin, they were super sowers of iniquity. So if you sow bountifully, this is divinely inspired. If you sow bountifully into, let's say, a wardrobe, you will what? You reap bountifully. Look at me right now. Fantastic. Look at Rick back there. Weak. Look at this. Oh, tsunami. But if you sow what? Sparingly, you reap. There in it, law of the spirit world. Can't get away from it. Do not be deceived. You're not fooling God. Check it out. Whatever you sow in this life, you will reap. And I'll tell you what, there isn't a second go by of your life. If you stop to listen, you will see that law in play virtually every second of your life. Every person that's mentally ill sowed into what? Listening to lies. Listening to demons, listening to things that weren't true, not listening to God's word, not listening to truth. Boom, now they got a mental illness. Now they got a negative thought disorder. Now they've got PTSD. You're listening to them. You're reaping them. You listen to God's word, you reap it. The sowing and reaping applies everywhere. Are you kidding me? People die in America like you wouldn't believe. Why? Drive-thrus. People eat crap here. So that's what we do. It's part of our culture. Yeah, and it goes down well. Tastes great. I went over that issue last week with Filiberto's. But if you treat your body or hurt your body a certain way, and you, whatever, it all comes right back to haunt you. You get sick, you get fat, you get this, you get that. Whatever it is you get, that's what you got. That's deep, sir. You following this? I'm sharing these things with you. See, whatever you get, that's what you got. You don't have a master's degree. You got a doctor's degree. I don't want to talk to you. You don't have a master's degree. See it flowing there? Whatever you get, that's what you got. And that's what you sowed. And that's what you reaped. It's as simple as that. It's third grade math. Are you going to do that? Well, there's ramifications of that. Are you going to say that? There's a ramification of that. Period. End of story. Who's it apply to? Every person breathing on the planet. Yeah, everything. Any level, anywhere. Your mama told you that. She's a baby. Something bothering me about him. Don't date him. Huh. 10 years later, you're sitting there, laying in bed. And that thought come back to you. Oh, I should have listened to mom. He's snoring right there. Didn't take a shower. Feet stink. Didn't take out the trash. Got laid off. You're laying here, listening to mama, thinking about crack. Hey, you sowed it. Now you're reaping it. Go on to the next one. But conversely, the other side of the coin is if you sow to the things of God, you will start reaping them left and right. And it doesn't matter who you are. God has no favorites. The Bible says he's not a respecter of person. He doesn't see one person different than the other one. If you will obey and sow, you get these benefits. If you're not going to do it, you don't get them. Period. Third grade. Now, how are you going to do that? Well, you have to have a little patience because here's a great revelation in this text. The law of sowing and reaping doesn't instantly work. It's not like pinball. It's not like craps. It's not like cards. It's not like one-armed bandit. Notice I aged myself with those illustrations. You noticed that, didn't you? I know you did.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen instantaneously. Sometimes the reaping is delayed. Hell comes later, not right now. The blessings come later, not right now. Why? To have the blessings of the Spirit, you must develop, as the Apostle Peter taught us, patience. Americans hate patience. Why? Drive-thrus. Our whole country is screwed up for one reason. Is it Bush and Obama? No, it's drive-thrus. You heard that here first. You got to be patient. If we faint, how'd that go? Oh, there's nobody mad at me tonight. Oh, this is going to be great. Oh, it's early. Thank you. Let's go to 15 then. Since it's early, let's get to it. Now, Jesus wanted to teach you an important thing here, and this is important if you're going to be going in the ministry, which I hope most of you are. You have to learn how the gospel works. What's the mechanics of it? What's the nuts and bolts of it? How does it work? Jesus gave us the information. It's fantastic. In these three chapters, you need to become an expert on this, the most important of all parables. This is the most important parable you'll ever read. Jesus said, as you know, you've already read it, the minister, the preacher, whoever it is, the Lord sows seed like a farmer, and it lands on different kinds of ground. One type of ground it lands on is the side of the road. The flat side, nothing to it. Nothing growing there, nothing going on. That is, check it out, that's equivalent of someone who hears the word, but doesn't get it for whatever reason. It doesn't say why they don't get it. Could have been different reasons. And the devil then sees they don't get it, so he comes and snatches it away from them so they don't get it later. Is anybody listening to me? How does he do that? It's supernatural. He actually has to dig inside the person's inner man and he can pull it out of there. Now that's amazing. Spiritual, supernatural. So, if I hear the word, there goes the grain. You heard it. Your mind absorbed it. Before it can get into your spirit, man, and prosper, the devil supernaturally comes in there and grabs it out. The wayside. The person never gets saved. They never get nothing. It amounts to nothing. Everybody with me? Then he says, the gospel works like this. You throw the word out. There goes the seed. They hear it. And it registers with them. Boom! There's a transformation. Wow, this is fantastic. This is the gospel. I wanted to be saved. I wanted to be healed. I wanted to be delivered. This is fabulous. Thank you. But what happens? Instead of digging in and renewing their mind and pursuing it, what happens on the stony ground? It doesn't have any root. So they last for a while, and then something comes along. Who sent it? Yes, the devil sends it. He saw you hear it. Remember the other one, it went on the wayside. He saw you hear it. The demons were there. And they heard you hear it. They saw you hear it. So they snatched it out of there. Now he does it again. He sees what happens. And he sees he's in trouble. Hey, this is starting to take root. But we've got to stop it before it catches in his spirit, man, and starts to grow. So the person doesn't water. It's laying among the stones. It's got no depth and no root. And oh boy, they lose. Then this word of God goes out and it falls among the thorns. Whoa, there wasn't thorns there in the first place, was there? No, it says it grows up. Who causes it to grow? The devil causes these thorns to grow up. And what happens? They heard the word and they actually put it into practice. They are now saved or whatever it is, and they're heading out. Hey, I've got to do the will of God. I'm going to amount to something here. Guess what? The age runs up to them and catches them. They get caught up, particularly here in America, the richest country in the world. Here in America, it's the worst there is. There's too much to do here. Pleasures and lies and apate. Money is a delusion in this country. If you didn't learn that over the last recession, you're a very slow learner. Money disappears quickly when the government and the crooks on Wall Street take over. Your money gone. It's apate, it's a delusion. The security of money is a delusion. And lusting for things, stuff, material things, careers, retirements, whatever, vacation, whatever it is. They lust after these other things. And they already went forward. They were doing great. But then they become unfruitful and, in a way, fizzle out. Boy, that is so true of most Christians. They fizzle out like crazy. I've told you this 1,000 times, but Billy Graham and Luis Palau keep statistics on their new converts in these gigantic ministries. And these two ministries don't do, you know, healing, deliverance, and miracle. They're just salvation ministries. And they keep statistics on them. And they found out by their own records, they lose 85 to 90% of their converts. What's happening there? It's the parable of the sower come to life. This parable is being illustrated in these big ministries. The seed goes out, Billy preaching, great preacher, Luis Palau, great preacher. Seed goes out, it, to use a slang term, fizzles out. The person fizzles out. And they don't become diddly squat for the kingdom of God. Happens all the time. Horrible. He hears and understands. What kind of ground? Good ground. I come here every Friday wanting one thing, this. I'm looking for some people here who are good ground. It's not just me. It's every teacher, preacher, missionary, anybody in the ministry, Rick in the jails, anybody. That's what you're really looking for when you go out hunting to the gospel, teaching and preaching. You're looking for somebody who's good ground. It's so wonderful to see somebody with good ground. Boy, it feels good. If it feels good, I'm saying that by faith. Good ground people are absolutely fantastic, aren't they? Oh, they're so great. And everybody kind of starts out that way, don't they? You ever seen the new convert with a little first love going there? They get saved and they end up in some church. And everybody hates them. Man, you can't be around a new convert who's got first love thing. It makes you sick to your stomach. You'll run out the door. Because they'll put everybody to shame. And you feel the shame. You feel it. They're like, oh, I love the Lord. Hi, don't you? And you're going, oh. Yeah, well, I've been as a Christian for a while, so I'm kind of past that. Oh, Jesus! God, let's get out of here, you know. Golden Corral. Wow. First love people. Nauseating. They hear the word, they understand it, and oh, they bring forth fruit. And they bring, everybody's different. Everybody brings forth fruit in different levels. But they all do it with what? Again, patience. One thing Americans hate. Why? Drive-thrus. People don't like anything that has to do with patience. They hate it. Plague. I want my miracle now, my ministry now, I want to be healed now, I want my deliverance now, I want everything, I want you to cough it up now. No, it does not work that way. Yeah, it takes time to renew your mind. You have to be patient. Study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman that does not need to be ashamed. How do they do that? They have patience. Patience brings huge victories. Huge victories. Back in the early 1940s, Catherine Kuhlman got saved, and she had that first love thing. They kicked her out of the Baptist church. So she started to travel around the country as a Baptist preacher. And she sometimes would sleep in the barn, or she'd sleep outside. So what did she do? She just kept going. Why? She understood that this thing required patience. Decades later, she's pastoring a church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Some lady walks up after the service. She says, while you were talking, my back just healed. No one prayed for me. Click! Light bulb went off in her head. She had put in years of patience. That next Sunday, her worldwide ministry started. Nobody getting prayed for. Everybody getting healed. How did it happen? Years of patience. Sleeping in the chicken coop. Sleeping outside. Sleeping in a rundown one bedroom. Sleeping in a dumpy hotel. Not getting paid. Skipping meals. She had patience. Boom. What was little Catherine? Good ground. What are you? Good ground. You're good ground. You. Hey, we might have a Catherine Kuhlman. I hear one back there just starting. We might have another one out here, Catherine Kuhlman. You never know, because somebody may say, hey, wait a minute here. God, Brother Mike, that's right. I do have to make a sacrifice. I do need some patience. Yeah, I can't have everything right now when I want it. That's right. I'm going to do what she did. I'm going to sleep in the chicken coop. I'll just wait for my moment. Notice in this parable, only 25% were good ground. Wow. 25%, that's a high percentage. That's a high percentage. That was a percentage 2,000 years ago. Now it's... All right, well, let me try another one here you won't like. Here's absolute truth number 16. Here's what people don't understand about God. People, Christians, disciples don't. This doesn't apply to disciples. Christians have a problem with God. I mean, there's a lot of stuff about him they don't like. He pisses them off. He frustrates them. And it's all demonic lies. None of it is true. There's not a thing wrong with him. Our perception is wrong. He's fine. I'll show it to you. God wants to heal, save, and deliver everybody without an exception. 1 John chapter 3, the purpose of the Son of God was to unloose, untie, unchain the works of the devil. So that means anything the devil did, God wants to unloose or undo. Anything, name it. Just name something. Yes, anything. Anything. there's a luau going on back there for this purpose. Matthew 8. The leper came to Jesus, and God said, guess what? He says, if you want to help me, you can make me clean. See, the leper knew he could do it, but wasn't sure he wanted to do it. And American Christians are the same. They come to God and they're praying, but they've got doubt in their prayers. Their prayers never get answered. Why? Because they're doubting whether he wants to do it or not. Are you sure he wants to heal? Are you sure he wants to help us? I'm not 100% sure. Boom, there goes your prayer. And Jesus says, I want to. Period, God said. Up front, right there. Period. Period. I don't care what the Bible scholar told you. I don't care what they said at Moody Bible Institute. I don't care what they teach there. God said, I want to. Luke chapter 12. These scriptures appear to be insane. Seek not what you shall eat or drink or be of doubtful mind. Now this verse makes no sense at all here in America. But it made a lot of sense 2,000 years ago. Why is that? There was a lot of poverty and unemployment back in those days. Is that true? I mean, there weren't a lot of jobs. Almost everybody worked in agriculture. That was the big profession, or construction, mostly agriculture. Everybody was poor. So they would seek out people who dabbled in the spirit world to get benefits. Hey, will you conjure up this or do something, check the stars for me, or go. Everybody back then was involved in some kind of witchcraft. And that's what this verse is talking about. It makes no sense now. Meteorizomai was a term used to get information out of the stars and the asteroids and so on to get help. But when I was in Nigeria, some pastor told me something I'd never heard before. He told me about dwarf demons. I'd never even heard of a dwarf demon before. I had no idea what they did. Well, apparently, several pastors told me this, by the way. These dwarf demons come to families and they make a deal with the family to offer the daughters to the dad sexually. Incest. They're incest spirits. And if the family will agree to offer the daughter to the dad and the mother will go along with it, and that's a normal part of the family, sex with the daughter, these dwarf demons take care of them. And every pastor I talk to, I've never seen this myself, I'm just telling you what they told me. They would walk along and see money, there would be food on the table. Supernatural miracles would happen to these families that would give their children to incest, the daughters, to the dads. Dwarf demons. Well, it was kind of like what this is. They're looking for help from somewhere. Because everybody broke. Everybody's short of, you know, everybody need help. But Jesus said, I don't want you to do that. You don't need to do that. See? You don't need to go to any other source, spiritual or non. I'll take care of this for you. Your Heavenly Father already knows what you need before you ask Him. The nations of the world were doing that. Now, it doesn't happen. Okay, here in America, it means that this verse means nothing here. There's a place to get something to eat everywhere here. Grocery stores all over. Short stops, QTs, everything. You can get food anywhere here. Food out of our mind here. There, they did not have that. That makes sense? So that verse makes sense 2,000 years ago. But this verse makes sense now, if you can believe it. Your Heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask Him. So you don't need to sit around asking Him to meet your basic needs. Those are already covered in the gospel. You can stop wasting your time praying about that. You can pray about something that's important, like someone else who needs help or someone else who needs healing, or your ministry or your anointing, whatever it is. Pray for something important and spend your energy and time on that. Don't worry about your necessities. Father's got that covered. Don't be like the nations. That makes sense. Yeah, absolutely. You'll just get all these things given to you if you'll just take care of my business, I'll take care of yours. Why is that? God knows that if you spend all your time and energy just corralling your basic necessities, He knows you're not going to have any time for nothing. It's going to eat up all your time and energy. Workaholics, we have now. Working all the time. You need to do that. Your Heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask Him. He's got this thing covered. He's on that. So fear not, He says. You don't be afraid. Your Father, Heavenly Father, instead of being somebody you getting frustrated and pissed off with, hey, listen. He's happy to help you. He likes helping you. He wants to help you. Yeah. Listen, I know how tough things are. A lot of people have really bad things happen to their family. They have children that are disabled. They have different things hit them. Yeah, I'm with you on that. I understand all that. But if you put the thing into perspective, you're fine with it. Hey, Father knows what I need before I ask. I don't need to keep harping on that subject. Father's got this stuff covered. Yeah, He knows you're having some tough times. Yeah, He knows things are difficult. He's going to come through on this thing. You've got to keep on believing. Ephesians chapter 2. When we were dead in sins, we were quickened together with Christ. Every person here who is a born-again Christian has been quickened. You've been raised up to sit where? In heavenly places. Now, this verse is misinterpreted a lot, but it doesn't mean heaven, where God lives. We're not there yet. You'll be going there after you kick the bucket. Anybody here close to kicking the bucket? Nobody? Good. Okay, well, you're not going to heaven anytime soon, but you're already in Epiphanius, the heavenly atmosphere surrounding the planet in Christ. You are already above it all. You are up here looking down on this rat race. The reason it's not working for you is because you haven't come up here. You're still living in the rat race, worrying about your necessities, seeking help from other spiritual sources. You are actually spiritually seated in the heavenly atmosphere above the fray. It's your choice to live there or not. Why did God do all this for us? Because He's showing off. Showing off what? His eternal kindness. That's why He wants everybody saved. If God's perfect will were on the planet Earth right now, everybody gets saved. Every person. Terrorists, rapists, murderers, serial killers, bottom of the barrel politicians. They would all what? They'd all get saved. Okay, but Father doesn't get what He wants. But He's trying. Because you are saved. Why? How and why? Oh boy. Nothing you did saved you. You were saved through God's grace. You activated your faith in Christ's blood, and now you are sinless before Him. Looks like we've got a few backsliders here tonight. You are now sinless. Let's try this section. Nope, let's try this section. You, this row here then. All the people in that row, sinless. Why? God's grace, and they exercise faith in the blood of. They know they did not earn their salvation. It was given to them as a gift. This verse, God wants to apply to every human on the planet. And in eternity, when you're in the New Jerusalem, that's his trophy case, and you are his trophy. Illustrating the eternal kindness of God. That's your function and your existence on the planet. That's why you are here. And I go. All right, let's look at our time here. All right, I'm good for this one. Here's eternal truth, absolute truth number 17. Okay. Here's a problem. God has done all this for humanity and wants everybody to get saved and healed, everybody to get delivered, everybody home in heaven. I explained predestination to you. Prorizo is a Greek word. It means to get on the bus. Yeah. There's a gigantic bus filled with seats. As of right now, let's say there's 7 billion seats on the bus. One for every human on the planet. Assuming there's 7 billion. I'm just guessing. That's what I read that. I don't know that. But each one of them seats on that bus, preach, has a name on that seat. Only one name. You. Your name is Steve, sir. You have one seat on that bus. Not as good as that one. But it's got your name on it and no one else's. And that bus, giant bus, 7 billion seats on it, is bound for glory. Yeah. Slaves in the 1800s called it Beulah Land. Beulah Land. That's where I want to go. I want out of here. I'm in the mood to go to Beulah Land. 7 billion seats, one name per seat. Well, that bus someday will pull into Beulah Land, glory. And some of the seats will be filled with the people with their name on it. And the other seats will have a name on it, but nobody's sitting in it. Prorizo, predestination, is that God has pre-chosen and preordained you to be on that bus, sitting in your seat, when it pulls into the bus stop at Beulah Land. You are predestined, pre-chosen, and preordained to be on that seat. Why are the seats empty? The person chose not to get on. There you go. How'd you like that definition? Why don't you mail that to the Moody Bible Institute and tell them to stick that in their concordance. Oh, God has chosen you to go to hell and you to go to heaven. That's horse manure. It's not what the Greek word means. They're lying. He chose everybody to go. There's a seat on that bus for everybody. Going home to Beulah Land. But you choose whether you get on that bus and take your seat. You, preacher, already chose to take your seat. You chose it. You. No one else can sit in that seat. It shows up in heaven empty or you're in it. Period. Predestination. All right. Jesus told the Jews something that blew their mind. Doesn't mean much now, but back then this was huge. This caused a riot. He said, listen, if you don't believe that I'm God essentially, paraphrasing, you're going to die in your sins. Can you imagine saying that to a Pharisee with 5 doctor's degree? He would have freaked. They did freak. They murdered him. They tortured him. If you do not believe that, and go in me, I am. In the Greek. Hebrew. Yah, Asher, Ayah. Jehovah told Moses, you tell them, I am sent you. What's that mean? I am the eternal, self-existent, everlasting one. I am God Almighty, El Shaddai. Jesus said, ego in me. That was the same as that. They freaked. Where's your family? We know your family here. You're just a carpenter. You're from Nazareth, everybody. From Nazareth, a loser. That's what they told him. They said, what do you mean you're not dying in our sins? We're not dying in our sins. We, our father's Abraham. He said, hey, your father is the devil. How the heck did he have the guts to preach that message? I wouldn't have done it. Yeah. If I was alive back there, I'd be a Seeker Frenzy TV preacher. Jesus, have a nerve I can't even dream of having, made that statement in front of a bunch of Jews. Unbelievable. What's going to happen to you if you don't get on that bus? What's going to happen to you if you don't get on that bus? Whether you're saved or you become an apostate, you were saved, you were filled with the Spirit, but you told the good Lord to shove it, and you went back into the world, and you deliberately, and of your own free will, turned your back on God, and you became an apostate. What happens to you? What happens to every member of your family that's not born again? What happens to them? Revelation chapter 20. Fugo, verb. Now that's a present continuous tense verb. That means that the glory of God causes the heaven and earth to try to get away, but it can't. It acts like it's trying to get away, but it can't get away. There was found no place for them. In other words, I just translate it. They can't get away. They can't get out. Heaven can't get away. Neither can the earth. It's stuck there, but it's trying to get away. Before the glory of God, Jehovah on the throne, in the throne room, wherever that is. Doesn't matter who you are. You're Donald Trump or you're a transient in South Phoenix. It doesn't matter who you are. Doesn't matter what you did in those. It doesn't matter how much money you had or who thought what of you or who you were in this world. Nothing matters. Nothing matters. Nothing. All you got to do to qualify for this is to be dead. What are your chances of dying? Fairly high. You will stand, if you're not on that bus to Beulah Land, you stand. You don't sit. Standing before Jehovah throne room, and then they go over and get some reference material, and they got a book with your name on it. Instead of you on the bus in your seat with your name on it, which you could have taken from your own free will, but your own free will told you, I'm not getting on the bus, I'm staying out here. You chose not to take your seat. Now your name is transferred to a book in heaven. In Greek, it's actually a scroll. Your name's on that scroll. There it is. Scrolls are open. Another one. And the Book of Life scroll is open. And somebody's looking on that scroll for your name. Your name's not on that Book of Life book. You're in the other book. And in the other book, scroll, everything you did is in that book. Everything you said is in that book. Billions, tens of billions of humans standing there. To qualify for this, all you have to do is refuse that seat on that bus and be dead. It says here the dead. You could drown the dead in hell, the dead anywhere, doesn't matter. Everybody is what? Judged out of that book. It's got your name on that scroll. If you didn't take your seat and you didn't come in on the heavenly bus, you got to go to the white throne judgment, because you essentially said, what Christ did for me, what God did for me, the blood of Christ, the whole kit and caboodle, the entire gospel, I'm not interested. I'm busy. I got the pleasures of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, the lust of other things, and I'm not interested. So they look for your name in the book of life. You're not on that scroll. They go to the other scroll. Oh, there you are. Oh, this is the one that's got everything you ever said and everything you ever did in it. And here it is. Let me look through this thing and read all that in front of everybody. Billions of people. How many angels? I don't know. Gazillions. Who knows what's up there? And guess what? Balo means to throw. Throw. You are thrown after they're done reading that scroll with your name on it. And everything you ever said and everything you ever did, it's on that scroll. You were not born again. You were not filled with the Spirit. Nope. I don't need any of this gospel stuff. I heard the gospel and it entered my heart, but Satan, I didn't, it just, he took it out of my heart. It didn't amount to anything. I didn't bear any fruit. I just went on my merry way. There's that scroll with your name in it. And you ended up where? The one place the devil fears, where he's going, and all of his friends will be there. Here, limne pur is a Greek phrase. It means the pond of flames, and it's in the center of the earth. So if you go dig down here, X amount of miles, boom, you run into the lake of fire, according to the Bible. It's right in the center of the earth. Exactly where it is, I don't know. And all your relatives and friends and everybody you grew up with, the college and everybody, they're all in there. Almost all of them die and go to hell. Almost everybody dies and go to hell, according to Jesus. Few people find the narrow gate. Few people go there, he said. The wide gate, the broad road, many, he said, go there. So the bus pulling into heaven is much smaller than the number of people being thrown. They don't go there voluntarily. You've got to be thrown into hell. You're trying everything you can to get out of it and get away. They're thrown into what's the nightmare of this? My God, it's unbelievable. What do you live? 73.2 years average life expectancy here in America. Yeah. Right? Approximately, thereabouts. So let's say that you didn't do anything but eat Wheaties. You never smoked or drank or nothing. You got your exercise. Let's say you lived to 100 and something. Well, who's the oldest person? 100 and what? Somebody was 121 China. Okay, there you go. China. See what I mean? China. That figures. Here's a guy eating vegetables, fruits and vegetables. Chinese people have no fun whatsoever. You know why? They don't have drive-through there. We got them here. Drive-throughs are fun. They're a total joy. But in China, so they don't have that. So you're eating your fruits and vegetables, and you live to 121. Who cares? Eternity is millions, you're not on that bus, you're 121 years old. If he's in China, let's say he's a Buddhist, the poor guy dies. Oh my God, here's where he ends up, right here. Thrown into the... Why? Because he's essentially saying, Jesus, no, Buddha, yeah. All the Muslims, where are they going to end up? Thrown into... Why? Allah, yes. Christ's blood, no. They all go to hell. 9/11. Boom. Who were the first people in hell? The guys in the cockpit. Who are the second people in hell? The poor passengers. Why? No blood of Jesus. You will die in your sins if you do not believe I am God, he said to the Jews, and he's saying here today. If you die in your sins, this is what happens to you. Croesus, you will be evaluated. When? After you're dead. Everyone is evaluated after they're dead, whether they're saved or not. Nobody escapes it. Revelation 21, who goes to hell? It's this load of people here. Delos, what is that? Cowards. Cowards, unbelievers. Delusimai, people that do disgusting things. Murderers, whoremongers, pornos, what's that? Male whores, sorcerers, what's a pharmacus? That's a witch that uses potions and drugs and stuff. Idolaters, guy was 121 in China, Buddha, idolater, boom. Thrown in, screaming, no, splash. You're screaming to get out of it and can't do it. Oh, what? Holy smoke. Everybody you ever voted for is going to hell. Every single person you ever voted for. In that card, next time you vote, just go down there praying. Oh, God, they're all going, oh, Jesus, hell, 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 hell. Why? They're all lying. They're lying. If you lie for a living, you go to hell. Duh. Hello. They fool us. They don't fool the Holy Ghost. Those are lies. See? If you like your plan, you go ahead and keep your plan. Then you go to hell. You burn in hell when you keep a plan. That was a lie. Weapons of mass destruction. Go to hell after you tell the people that. Why? You're lying. You're a liar. You lie all the time. Why? You're insecure. Why? You got low self-esteem. So you lie to cover up stuff. You lie to get out of stuff. You lie to keep from getting embarrassed. That's why people lie. Or you lie to earn money. You're a TV preacher. You lie because you're a politician. You want votes. Doesn't matter. You're lying. You get thrown. You don't go voluntarily. You go screaming. You're thrown in. You don't just walk in and say, well, you're right. I did all those bad things. I'm so sorry. I'll just die. You're right. No, you're trying to get out of it. Desperate people say anything to get out of something. Nothing works. Nothing works. You weren't on the bus. You didn't want that seat. And so everything you ever said and everything you ever did is played back right in front of you. In front of everybody. Everybody gets to see you committing adultery. Everybody gets to see you lying. Everybody gets to see you insulting your parents and yelling at them. It's all played back. Man, nobody realizes in America how serious the gospel is. How serious this whole thing is. Nobody sees it. You know why? Hell is bad news. Americans hate bad news. We don't want to hear it. We want a feel-good story, you know? We want a Kansas City Royals story. Somebody that comes from the bottom of the barrel, nobody expects to win, wins all their games. Oh, that's what we really like. That's what we like. Americans don't like this. They don't like ramifications. They don't like accountability. That's the last thing we want. We just want to skate through this thing. It's not going to happen to us. It's not going to happen. All right, let's close with this then. The parable of the wheat and tares. Remember the story? Quickly, there goes all the seed out in the field. Oh, look, all these great crops are growing up. Fruit all over the place. Wait a minute, there's something else growing right with the fruit and the crop. What is it? Oh, gosh. Well, it's God who sows his word And he sows it cosmos, in humanity, in the human world. And the good seed that come up, the wheat, are the guys with their name on the bus that took their seat. They took their seat on the bus of their own free will. The tares are what? Fake Christian, phony Christians, American Christians. People that get saved, they just say the sinner's prayer and fill out a card. Oh, I'm saved. Now I'm going back to my... People who are carnal Christians, people who are lukewarm. Tares in the church, they look exactly like other Christians. Wearing the same Easter bonnet, got the same outfit on, except something great like this, but they something like that and this stuff, normal stuff. They're wearing the same clothes. Tares, wheat. They look like Christians. They even talk like it. They've got all the Christian stuff down. God bless you, brother. Pray the Lord. God bless them. They got it. Oh, shoot. You think they're Christians? Well, Bob's here every day. Every Sunday. He always sits in that chair. Yeah. He's a great guy. They look like they're Christians. But in fact, they're tares. That's right. Now I'm talking about your relationships. Yeah, a plant. The devil sent you that relationship. Why? To destroy you. Yes. Yeah, he sent you that guy. He sent you that girl. Oh my goodness. That girl was a tare. She was a plant. Tares are planted all over the church, and they look like Christians. They sound like Christians. Fake. They are actually really what? They're not even saved. They're like the Jewish Pharisees. You are of your father, the devil. And the works of your father you will do. He was a liar and a murderer from the beginning. He abides not in the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks on his own, for he is a liar and the father of lies. And all liars have their part in the lake that burns with. Americans have no idea how serious the gospel is. This stuff is serious. It's real. Why? Because most of the people that fill churches, they're tares. I saw a movie last week. I don't go to very many movies. I saw one last week. You know what it was called? Left Behind. That's right. Some actor that was in that movie, I can't hardly stomach the guy. His name's Nicolas Cage. I do not like that guy at all. Makes me sick. He starred in that movie. And all of a sudden, they're on this plane. See? And some people were at the shopping mall. And there's two scenes. There's a shopping mall scene, airplane. Nicolas Cage is the pilot on the airplane. All of a sudden, this girl's hugging her younger baby brother in the mall. Nicolas Cage is back flirting with one of the stewardesses who he's having an affair with. He's married. And the co-pilot is handling the plane. All of a sudden, boom! Just like that. It sounded like that, too. Boom! The kid disappears. And the girl's going, where's my baby brother? Well, all the kids in the mall disappeared. So everybody at the mall, the playground area of this giant mall, they're freaking out. Well, 6, 7, 8 people on the plane disappeared, including the co-pilot. So it took you through this all this drama. Oh, my God, they're going to crash. Then everybody's hunting for their people. You know what I honestly think? I can't prove this. This is only my own opinion. I think the rapture is going to be over in about 48 hours. So few people are going to go in the rapture, and the secular media will gloss over it so quickly and easily, like they do everything else they don't like. I mean, it's like nothing. That rapture thing is going to last about 2 or 3 days. Where do these people go? Boop. It's old news. You know why? There'll be so few people going. You know why? Tares, lukewarm, carnal Christians, American Christians, left behind. is ridiculous. The whole planet's not shook up over the rapture. There aren't that many people going. There's 7 billion on people on the planet. What? Who's going to care? Who cares if a few million disappear? Nobody cares. Nobody. It's not working. All Washington D.C. will be completely populated. All these mega churches. There'll be a couple of people scattered here and there. Where's Bob at? Oh, he went to the Golden Corral early. You know, nobody's going to even notice. Dick's not there. Where's Sally? But they'll notice it in the nursery. Not one baby in the nursery. Where the heck are all the kids? What happened here? What's going on? Where's the kids at? Kids are going to be gone. All the kids will be gone. No kids go to hell. That's another Bible study. There's tares all over the place, and the devil puts them in your life. He sows them into your church, into your life. He sent you that man. He sent you that woman. At the end of the age, it's going to happen. The harvest. The angels go through and they pick out all the tares, bundle them up, and do what with them? Oh, my God. Yes. They are what? Burned. What do you do when you're in the lake of fire? What's your hobby? Wailing. And what is that symbolic of? Severe pain. Gnashing your teeth. Oh, this hurts so bad. I'm crunching my teeth. Now, that's real pain. That's grinding pain of some kind. What it is, I don't know, but it's not a good picture. And then we come to the Christians. Those are the sinners. Now what about these Christians? Well, this is not good. You know, hey, you know this parable. Some guy had two people that owed him money. This person owed him all kinds of money. This one owed him chump change. So the guy that owed all kinds of money, the guy said, hey, listen, I'm going to let you go. I'm going to forgive you. He runs off happy as he can be, runs into a friend of him that owes him chump change, lunch or something. Won't let him off. Pushes him to give him the money. Won't forgive him. He got forgiven this much. He won't forgive that much. What happens to him? Good Lord. These tormentors, in my opinion, are demons. And you got to reap what you sow. You got to pay for that in this life and the next one. And you're going to have to pay for everything in the next life. That's what it looks like. Who are tares? These people here are tares, according to the Bible. People who do not endure to the end. Huge in America. Huge numbers of Christians backsliding here in this country. Huge numbers. People who can't overcome. Your typical carnal, lukewarm Christian. They got all these bondages in their life. They never overcome them. They never change. They just keep doing the same thing over and over. Christians who look back. Oh, pillar of salt. And here it is, an actual picture of the lake of fire. I don't know where this footage came from. But that's what it kind of looks like. You see that? That's molten lava. And the Bible says there's sulfur in hell. And scientists have proven beyond a shadow of a doubt the center of the earth is made out of sulfur. And there's poisonous sulfurous gases down there that would kill you in a billionth of a second. In the center of the earth. And I think what hell looks like, I think in my opinion, I can't prove this, I think it looks like the inside of a volcano.
With no light. I agree with that, with no light.
No light, but the burning fire. See, you're in total dark. See how dark it is? See the darkness here? You're totally dark. And all you see is the fires here. And then you have the wailing and gnashing teeth somehow distributed somewhere. I don't exactly know how it works, obviously, but I haven't been there. But in my opinion, this is the closest thing known to man to accurately depict Limne Pur, the lake of fire. It's the center of a volcano full of sulfur, and we know that for a fact because the Bible says there's sulfur in hell. How'd that go? All right. Remember, these are absolute truths. 8, 17 of them. You have to have these truths down pat in order to have a full gospel, Holy Spirit ministry. And so you don't get caught by the devil on some false doctrine, get tripped up in an argument somewhere. Remember, somebody wants to argue about Scripture with you, that's usually demonic. Argumentative is usually demonic. Okay? Sometimes you're trying to get some truth through to somebody, and that's happened to me before. I've fell into that trap a couple times. I always had to repent of it. And I got kind of upset. You're explaining something to somebody, and they're not listening. You know, you go over it again, and you give them the facts like a second grader. They're still not listening. You know, it's all a setup. It's a plant. The devil's trying to get you upset over somebody who's not listening. They wouldn't listen if the Pope told them the Scripture, let alone you telling them. You shouldn't even be getting in an argument about it. That's a red flag. You've got some problems you need to get fixed. Still praying here. Still believing. Those 17 truths you have to survive in the spirit world. These are important truths you have to have, and you must understand these things. This is the truth of the gospel. This isn't the stuff you get off TV. Where you walk by a, you know, car dealership, and you blab a limo. That limo is mine in the name of Jesus. And then go home and look for it parked. You don't. Okay, this isn't an essential truth. That's something else. These are essential truths of the gospel you have to have. Okay, and that concludes our Bible study. We will finish it. Finish absolute truths next Friday, and that'll be the end of it. I promise. Okay. Strike that. Excuse me. I just heard the Lord talk to me. The seminar's next week. That's an absolute truth. There will not be absolute. Well, there'll be some truths in it, but they're not. You know, that's the absolute truth. Well, seminar's next week. Sorry. Then the next week, we will wrap up. The next week's Halloween. No, I'm not going to do one this year. I got tired of doing that Halloween seminar. I don't know why, but maybe I should have done it anyway. Send me an email if you want to hear that Halloween seminar on Halloween. All right. So, yeah, I'm not going to do it unless I hear from you. All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word, because I've just picked out a few absolute truths, but I know there are more than that. But these are absolute truths from God's holy word. And Lord, tonight, absolute truth number 15, you want to heal and save and deliver everyone. You want everyone to be on that bus bound for glory, Beulah Land. You have predestined each of us, pre-chosen and preordained each person in this room to be on that bus, each person to escape judgment and the damnation of the fires of hell. You have chosen and ordained each person in this room, and you want to heal and save and deliver everyone. And tonight at the altar call, that's what's going to happen. Amen. Teaching is over. We will take a 5-minute break, and we will be right back here, because God wants to heal, save, deliver every person that stays here. Amen. You are loved and dismissed. Testing streamers. We're getting ready to start our healing service now. Please do not turn off your computers. Testing, 1, 2, 3, streamers, do not turn off your computers. We're going to start our healing service now. Raise your right hand if you need to be physically healed tonight, if something wrong with you physically. Keep them up there. Hey, will you call? James, can you call them out of the office? So they can see this, please. Okay. If you have a, if you need to be physically healed, raise your hand so my everybody in my staff can see you. Are the staff looking? There's a guy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Looks like a 7. 7 hands need to be physically healed. All right? Streamers, we're going to turn the lights off. We do that every Friday during the healing service to give people visual privacy. We're going to turn the lights off in the sanctuary. We're not trying to spook anybody. We want you to be able to sit there and not feel like somebody is staring at you. This is between you and God tonight. And there's about 7 people here that need to be physically healed. Okay? So we need 7 healings tonight. And the Bible says that God wants to heal and save and deliver every person. Every person. So that's what we believe. If you're not healed, something's blocking that healing. All you have to do is find out what's blocking it, and then you can get healed. That's all it is. It's not that God doesn't want to heal you. It's that something's blocking it. Okay? On the YouTube site, House of Healing AZ, I have a video on there, Why Christians Don't Get Healed, Healing Blockers. Okay? And I list the ones that typically block your healing. Okay? So we're going to turn out that light in the corner there. And then those of you who need to be physically healed, just stand up right now. Okay, now, can I have half the hardcore people in this aisle go down this aisle right here? Then half of my people go down this aisle. Come forward. If you're praying for people tonight, you should have a badge on. Half of my people in this aisle, half in that aisle right there. Go right there. Yeah, just stand there. Thank you. Yeah, just stand right in that aisle. Good. Stand up if you need to be physically healed. Ready? Now I'm going to pray now. Lord Jesus, we have laid out the red carpet for the Holy Ghost, and there are some people standing in their seats right now that need to be healed. And in Isaiah chapter 53, in Luke chapter 4, the Bible says that the Moshiach, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, the mighty Son of God, who came in the flesh and now sits at the right hand of Father in glory, has sent us the Holy Ghost. And each of these people standing has the Holy Ghost. And each of my friends that are going to now pray for them has the Holy Ghost. And tonight, Lord, we are looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And I am not looking to myself for anything at all. Zero. We are 100% looking to the broken body of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And in the name of Jesus Christ, I declare each of you, when the staff starts to pray for you, you are to receive your healing. When they touch you, you just take a big breath. Just raise your hands and open your heart. I'm going to count to 3. The Holy Spirit is here with the broken body of Jesus Christ. The broken body of Jesus heals. The broken body of Christ is the only thing that can heal. When I count to 3, Ron's going to turn on some worship music in the back. I'm going to count to 3. And the broken body of Jesus, nothing else and no one else, is going to heal your body when the hardcore people touch you in the name of Jesus. Are you ready? Now just take a big breath and relax. Take a big breath and relax. The broken body of Jesus. Yes. It's the broken body of Jesus Christ. Yes. It's the broken body of the Son of God. Yes. Who brings divine healing to the born again saint of God. If there's anything blocking your healing, you will repent of it right now. You will repent of it for this very instance. Bitterness, anger, frustration, disobedience, hidden sin, pornography, arguing, fighting, and lying. You will repent of it right this second in the name of Jesus. Right now, you'll repent of it in the name of Jesus. Just confess it right now so you can be healed. If you have doubt and unbelief in your heart, you confess it right now, right this second. Oh God, forgive me for my doubt. Forgive me for my unbelief. Oh Jesus, I'm asking you to have mercy on my soul. Oh Jesus, have mercy on my soul. 1, 2, 3, go! Receive your healing right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive your healing right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and His broken body, and His dripping blood. Receive your healing now in the mighty name of the Lord. Yes! You receive your healing now in Jesus' holy name. Heal in Jesus' mighty name. Thus saith the Lord. Heal in Jesus' mighty name. Receive your healing now in the name of the Lord. Go on and take it. Take a big breath and receive your healing. Streamers, put your hand on your body right now, right where that pain is, and command that pain to come out of your body. I command this pain in my knee in the name of Jesus. Come out of my knee right now in the name of the Lord. I command this pain in my low back. In Jesus' mighty name, I command you. Come out, you devil of pain, you demon of pain. I command you to come out of my body right now in the name of the Lord. You spirit of addiction, I curse you in the name of the Lord. Come out, you spirit of addiction, in the name of Jesus Christ. Move your body around and see if you're healed. Quickly. Move your body around. Have you been healed? Move your body around. Check your body out. Right now in Jesus' mighty name. Be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed in Jesus' mighty name. Healed right now by the broken body of Jesus Christ. Come on now, let's go. Just receive your healing. It's already been bought and paid for at Calvary. In Jesus' mighty name. Move your body around and see if you're healed. If you're not healed, put your hand on your head. Command that doubt and unbelief to come out of your brain right now. I command you, Satan. I command you, Satan. Loose your hold over my body right now in Jesus' holy name. If you've been healed, come forward. After you get healed, come forward. In the name of Jesus, the mighty Son of God. What do you need, sweetheart? What's wrong with you? Go ahead. You speak in tongues? Did you get healed? What happened? You what? Does it hurt now?
No.
Feel around there. Feel that? Does that hurt?
This woman standing right here. See this beautiful woman right over here on my right, your left. She was in some kind of an accident.
Hey, was that a car accident? Hey, was that a car accident or what? Workers' comp? In what? Is it gone?
Yeah.
This woman got in a car accident. See this girl right here? This pretty gal there on my right, on your left. Streamers, look over there. This woman got in a car accident, and she had a pinched nerve in her lower back down near her sacrum, and all the pain is gone right now. Here, I'll let you her tell you.
Go ahead. What's your name? Tell them about it.
My name's Carla. And
receive your healing right now in Jesus' mighty name. Come on now. Just receive it.
Been hurting me over a year now, and right now I just have somebody pray over me, and I feel no pain, no pressure at all, and I want to thank God for it.
You speak in tongues? You speak in tongues?
Come out!
Oh, you have it? Okay, time for that now. Ready? Speak it out. No, leave your hands up. Speak out. Put your hand up. Speak your hand up. Say that. Say that. Just repeat after me. Borre mushaba. Good girl. Let it out now. Go right now. Here, you got the giggles. Go ahead. Laugh it out. Go on. Laugh it out. Come on now. Who needs to be healed? First, we'll heal. If you are an addict, come down here to the front. You're an addict. You are addicted to food. You got obesity issues. You're addicted to alcohol. You're drunk. You're addicted to drugs. Drugs. Come down here. You're going to get instantly healed. Drugs. Come right down here. Medications. Come down here. Illegal drugs. You rotten devil of crack, coke, meth, heroin. I curse you in Jesus' name. I bind your powers.
Speak it out. Just like he used to. Relax and let it go.
Come on.
crack, meth, right now. Come down here. Come down here right now. You're getting healed now. You're getting healed right now. Hey, what's this guy doing? Hi, sir.
How's that?
What's wrong with him? Who are you? Grandson. Okay, what's wrong with you, sir? What do you mean you don't know? Why'd you bring him down here? What kind of drugs you on? Weed. Now, are you going to become a Christian tonight?
What?
Okay, good. Stay right there. Beautiful. What's wrong with you?
I've worked hard all my life. Just damage to my body. You know,
what's wrong with it?
So my wife wants me to get, because I take
two
to three Advil a day.
Okay. What's wrong with your body?
Labor job, right?
What's wrong with your body?
Just hard work. I mean, it's scar tissue.
Your back?
Yeah.
Low back?
Or left hand.
Okay. Now there's something else wrong here that's a lot worse than that, okay? Raise your hand here. Raise your hand there. Close your eyes.
Testing 1, 2, 3. This guy standing right here in this white shirt, his neck and his shoulder got healed, and now he's forgiving his ex-wife so the rest of him can get healed. Streamers, if you will not release and forgive every person in your life, you cannot get healed. That'll block your healing. All right, if you can think of one person you got bad feelings for, one person, ex-husband, ex-wife, son, daughter, brother, sister, mom, or dad, one person, that can block your healing, and you will not be healed, and you will not be delivered, especially if you got bad feelings for yourself. Streamers, you got bad feelings for yourself, you're in deep trouble. You're not going to get healed. And so, Lord, it's time to forgive completely tonight. What happened to you?
My name's Johnny Sanchez. I had a motorcycle accident. I hurt my head, my shoulders, broke my arm, my kidney, my knee, my foot. I've been out of work for a long time. And now I'm healed. I thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. I've been sitting at home seeing psychiatrists telling me I'm not going to be able to work no more. That's why I'm here, so I can get healed. I love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for opening my heart and letting go of all my hurts, Lord. I hated lawyers. I hated my boss. Come into my heart, Lord. I have...
This guy just got healed from being in a motorcycle accident. He had a bunch of stuff wrong with him. The Holy Ghost knows what you need before you ask him. He just wants you to confess it. If you'll confess it, he'll heal you and he'll forgive you. If you keep it to yourself, that means we lose. We got to lose. Okay? Well, you're not supposed to lose tonight. You're supposed to win. You're supposed to be winning tonight, not losing. Okay? This isn't church. It's a healing service. Just confess it right now. Go ahead and confess it right this second. Saints of God, all kinds of people are getting healed and delivered down at the altar tonight. Come on now, let's hurry it up. Hurry up and get healed. You're supposed to hurry and get healed. You hurry and release these people. You hurry and forgive them. Tonight in Jesus' mighty name, I release rape and kidnapping, verbal abuse, spousal abuse, negativity from my wife and my husband. I release all their cutting words. I forgive everything they said. And I now release every single one of them tonight. God, I ask you to forgive me for not trusting you. I ask you to forgive me for not repenting. What's your name?
Rosie.
Rosie? What was wrong with your body when you came up for prayer?
It was in a lot of pain. And when you're stressed, it hits your whole body. I mean, it just brings you down.
You were under a lot of stress?
A lot.
From what?
From everything.
You mean family or job or what?
Family. Family.
Did you repent of that tonight?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did.
Did any evil spirits come out of you?
Yes, I think they did. Yes.
Now, how does your back feel?
Good.
How about your neck and shoulders?
Good.
Good. Hear it cracking? Okay, that's the Holy Ghost healing it. Whenever it cracks, that's Him breaking it up. I don't exactly know how He does it, but I don't need to know as long as you get healed.
Yes.
Do you speak in tongues?
No.
This woman here is speaking in tongues for the first time in her life. The one that got her neck and back and shoulders healed, now she's speaking in tongues, so that's how you do it. Spike. Streamers, one person after the other has got a touch of the Holy Ghost down here tonight. You should have gotten yours. Go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com. Touch, hit the button called the teaching button. Hit the teaching button. Go down to the bottom teaching. And it says Satan's counterattack. He's going to attack you tomorrow, the next day, within the next 48 hours. He's going to make a move on you. Read that article on the website, the teaching button, so you do not get reinfected with spirits and so you do not lose your healing. The guy with the motorcycle accident got healed tonight. The other lady with a shoulder problem, she got healed. Go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com, and hit the post-deliverance button. There's a post-deliverance button. Read that article on the website so you do not lose your healing or your deliverance tonight. Post-deliverance. It's right on the website. If you got your gift of tongues tonight, I think four people got their gift of tongues tonight. Go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com, and hit the teaching button. Scroll down near the bottom of the page to the article on glossa. Glossa. Your gift of tongues. That article will show you what to do and how to do it. Your gift of tongues is your weapon in the war against Satan. Be sure to be here next Friday night for our seminar on familiar spirits, the chess players of the spirit world. Do not miss this seminar next Friday night on familiar spirits. They are the ones that are behind Halloween. They are the murderers and killers behind the second biggest holiday in America, Halloween. Number two holiday in America, after Christmas. HardcoreChristianity.com. See you next week.